All right. Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us tonight. My name is Jessica Kaplan, and I'm the Horticulture Manager here at the Conservancy. We are so excited about today's panel discussion. So this spring and summer, our horticulture exhibition at Madison Square Park will be called Spring Forward into Summer, and it has already started, as the name implies, and it will highlight the cut flower industry. This exhibition explores the utilitarian art, cyclical themes, and cultural significance of the cutting garden. For the second installment of this four-part horticulture Zoom series, we will be discussing, focusing on those wonderful cut flowers. And if you were with us 2 weeks ago, we had a great discussion with three New York City florists, talking all about how they make incredible displays with those cut flowers. And if you missed it, don't worry, you can find it on our website after this. I highly recommend you watch it. So our discussion today focuses on the growers in our area that produce the cut flowers needed for farmers markets, floral design, and so much more. And please stay tuned for the second half of our Horticulture Zoom series program, which will start back up again in August. So stay tuned for that. And just one housekeeping note before we get started. Please put your questions for our panelists in the Q&A located at the bottom of your screen. So tonight we're joined by a couple of people you see up here on our panel. We have Ayanna Milligan, a horticulture associate at the Conservancy, and two great growers, Candace Howard of Duchess Farms and Chris Losey of Silver Petals Farm. So I will give a quick introduction and then we will jump right in. Candace Howard started her floral career in 2014. As the owner of a wedding floral design business, she became keenly aware that there was a lack of quality local flowers in the marketplace. In 2018, Candace bought her 7-acre property in South Brunswick, New Jersey, and started Duchess Farms. Her locally grown flowers are now sold at farm markets, pop-up shops, and through a CSA membership program. In 2021, in response to the pandemic, and the supply chain issues that affected the flower industry, Candace co-founded the Jersey Cut Flower Market, a co-op for flower growers in New Jersey, funded by USDA. This wholesale market will open to the floral trade in April 2022, which we look forward to hearing more about, Candace. After living and working for many years in New York City, Chris Losey and his wife, Kim Shea, gave up their Brooklyn digs to start digging, literally, in the loamy soil of Columbia County, New Jersey. I'm sorry, New York. Their experiences starting up Silver Petals Farm, both good and otherwise, were chronicled in the 2003 memoir, Stronger Than Dirt, published by Three Rivers Press, we're looking at right now. Now, after 25 years of selling flowers to grateful New Yorkers at Grow NYC's green markets, he's wondering when it will be time to put his feet up by the fire and peruse seed catalogs, as he seems to recall he once was promised. So I think we can all relate to that. So we're gonna jump right in here. And we really just, you know, would love for you guys to explain a bit about yourselves and how you came to be a farmer. Chris, I think we'll start with you. Please explain what's going on in that background as well.
Sure. Let me start with the background. So right now we're in what I call the grow room, but it's just some flower seedlings back there. You can see there's a fluorescent light bank, and I'll lift it up for you. Have a look. So here are a bunch of little seedlings. And I think we've got some tomatoes going in there, and which is the only non-flower thing we grow. And what else? Maybe some celosia and some of the late blooming stuff. Mm-hmm. So that's what's going on there. Now, I thought it was kind of more interesting to be in the room kind of where things are growing, living things. My wife, I unfortunately doesn't reach the greenhouse. So this is the best that I could do right now. So you asked how I got started in all this. And I guess basically it was a misunderstanding. But I'm not angry about it anymore. Because many years ago, I lived in New York City and I had a business, and some of the business was with the New York State Parks Department. New York State, yeah, not the city, but the State Office of Parks Recreation. And I had a friend, we'll call him Dan. That's his name, so he'll answer to that. You know, we got very friendly as we were going to the different sites. And he said, you know, I know you're not that happy in your job right now. You know, there's this, you should consider growing, you know, going upstate and growing flowers, having a farm. It's really easy. And it's, you know, you can just work a few hours in the morning and you can sit back on the porch in the afternoon and relax. And so it was a lie. He lied, but I forgive him. because while it hasn't been easy, it has been a lot of fun. So that was 27 years ago, I think. I still can't really believe it, but I think this will be starting our 27th year in Green Market down in the city. So we're located about 2 hours north we're in Columbia County, right on the border of Dutchess County. And in fact, when I saw Candace's farm, I said, oh, we must be neighbors, but we're not. She's in New Jersey. Dutchess County is one border of our property. So Saturday, we come into the city and we sell flowers in the summer. We haven't started yet. We've grown a little bit. We've had our kids and other people working at market, and it's been a lot of fun. So that's kind of what we do.
Chris is really a veteran. I'm a newbie. So, I mean, Jessica told everybody a lot about my history, but it was really my husband who had the idea to grow flowers. And one day he said, why don't we get a piece of property and grow flowers for your weddings? And it sounded like a really good idea at the time, but it's just the number of flowers you need for one wedding is, you know, huge. You need hundreds and hundreds of flowers for one wedding. So I had no idea what I was getting myself into, but I really did find out pretty quickly that I liked the farming better than doing the weddings. So it just kind of, I phased out of doing weddings in 2020. My last wedding was actually January of 2020. So I missed that whole scene where everybody was canceling their weddings and, you know, people couldn't get flowers, and it was just a really difficult time for the industry, and I missed that. Instead, I was out in my backyard growing flowers, which was very, very comforting during that time. And I do think that farming and growing and just kind of working with the earth is a very comforting thing to do. So I figured out that was more important to me. And being able to grow a palette, you know, planning what you're going to grow and planning the colors and the flowers, and then seeing them come up and seeing that this was your design, this, you know, this was what you envisioned comes to life. And it's an amazing thing. But so a little bit of where we are, we're in South Brunswick. So we're kind of between New Brunswick and Princeton, like right off the turnpike. I guess everybody's pretty much right off the turnpike in New Jersey anyway. But so we do a number of, we're actually doing a new farm market this year called Cook's Market, which is part of Rutgers Gardens. We are doing a CSA again this year. And we are selling wholesale this year, which is the first time we're doing that. Now that there's this new wholesale outlet that, you know, we can talk about at some point. Actually selling flowers at least a month, 6 weeks earlier than I have before. So it's really nice selling flowers right now. Flowers that I grew in a high tunnel over the winter.
Awesome. Thank you. I always love hearing how everyone finds their way to this kind of profession. I think a lot of us can agree with just the therapeutic nature of working land. So I'm sure people are probably curious, what does a typical day look like for each of you? And Candace, if you would like to start.
Sure. So right now, the day right now is very different than what the day will be like a month from now, or even, you know, 2 months from now. So once a week, one day a week, I do my seed starting. I have a schedule of what seeds I'm sowing in what growing weeks. So I think this is week 17, right, Chris? Growing week 17, I think we're in.
Could be. I think in March at some.
You don't really keep track of the growing weeks.
No.
So is it the week is based on the horticultural calendar? So I believe it's week 17. So this week I started sunflowers. After we get past these next couple of days, I'll start planting out transplants. So right now my grow room is completely covered, like the floor, everything is covered in seedlings that I have to plant out. So mostly at this point, it's been bed prep. And so getting all the beds prepared for the season, putting compost on the beds, broad forking some of the beds. So since we're a no-till farm, we've actually created 8 new beds this year, no-till. So getting those beds ready, they've been tarped for, I don't know, 6 months or so to kill all the vegetation. So we're working on bed prep and seed starting. That's about what we're doing now. Once it gets farther into the season, we'll be doing harvesting. And then that'll be in the morning, early in the morning. And then in the afternoon, we'll probably do, you know, our bouquet making and all the things that we need to do for the market, for our CSA. We'll do a lot of weeding, and we'll also do fertilization, or we actually use regenerative farming solutions that we make on the farm. So we do foliar feeding, actually feeding our flowers right through the leaves. So that's basically a typical day. It's very physical. And it's always a challenge.
Yeah, and Chris, if you wanna pick up here, what does your typical day look like now and maybe in the middle of the heat of the sun?
My day? Well, let's just start out. We're in the middle of the field and it's the sun shining and there's a little breeze blowing and the flowers are nodding their heads and I hear the birds singing, and then I wake up and it's raining. But that doesn't matter because I still have to go outside and do whatever has to be done. But the guy who's delivering the poop, the liquid manure, probably isn't coming today because his truck's gonna get stuck. So that's not happening. But it doesn't matter because in the meantime, the fence has fallen down where the deer came through. So I probably got to go fix that. there is no really typical day, but the nice thing about it is it's as Candace says, it's very seasonal. It's so things happen at different times. Now I think Candace is probably, I'm going to guess, maybe 3 to 4 weeks ahead of me because you're further south and maybe also using some row protection or something. Start planting probably in like 3 weeks or so, maybe around May 20th is our target date. And we have about 4 or 5 acres enclosed in a deer fencing. It's pretty rural up here. So deer is a big problem. So the first thing we'll probably do is try to fix the fence. We had a number of trees come down on it. Part of it is a mesh fence and part of it is an electric fence. So the electric fence is pretty easy to fix. The mesh fence, unfortunately, has had the tree damage. So that's a lot of chainsaw work. But when that gets fixed, then the poop guy actually did come early this year. So we're going to till that into the soil. And that'll add a lot of organic material, which we really need. Mm-hmm. Very good soil, bottom land. It's capability class 1 soil, which is, it's a small percentage of the soil in our area, but we happen to have it and it's great, but it still needs organic, you know, material and amendments and then some fertilizer. We're not certified organic, but we do use organic fertilizer and we don't use any pesticides or herbicides as controls. But we do plant in mulch rows and plastic mulch. So basically the sequence would be after the fence is fixed and the field is tilled in and fertilized, we lay down the mulch and then we burn holes in it where the plants are gonna go. Then we go out and plant the seeds or the seedlings. Some is direct seeded. Candace, you're starting sunflowers inside, it sounds like.
Yes.
That's great. I've never tried that. It probably should try, but we plant that directly in the field. Mm-hmm. Those zinnias are direct seeded. What else? Most of the other stuff is from starts. So we'll plant, plant that. That should be in there by end of May. And then we'll be weeding and thinning through June. And then hopefully early July, we'll start harvesting and going down to market. And from there on, I don't know if everybody does this, but we reach a point in, we try to keep everything looking pretty nice, keep it mowed and keep the weeds down. But you reach a point, like July, maybe, when you just say, no, that's it.
Whatever. Done.
It is what it is. Like, I can still walk through the weeds. I can still get in there and harvest flowers, and that's good enough. From there on until frost, you know, it is what it is. So the days vary a lot depending on, you know, the tasks that have to be done. Friday is a really busy day because it's the day before market. So we have to get everything picked and in water and in the buckets, and the truck's got to be all ready. And Saturday is usually our market day. Early in the week, we might get down to do weeding and mowing and stuff like that during the harvest season. And just try to keep up with it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure as we kind of get into summer here and we have, you know, a lot more plants that we're taking care of, we'll probably be reaching out to you guys with some suggestions, I'm sure. And it's really great to kind of start to hear some of your practices. And we'll kind of get into that a little later, talking about any of your sustainable practices. So we'll get to talk about that a bit more. But I would like to talk about, you know, atypical times and COVID, because obviously, you know, that's still at the top of people's minds. So how did things change for you during COVID? Positive, negatives? Chris, if you'd like to go first.
Sure. Like Candace, we do some weddings, and they can be a lot of fun, and we don't try to do a lot, but people who are going to get married in our area and, you know, want the kind of flowers that we grow, we'll do some. So obviously when that hit, I think every wedding got canceled. So that was out. Then the question was, were we going to be allowed to come into to sell at farmers markets? And Green Market, the umbrella organization, was was pretty proactive about getting the city to issue whatever permits or waivers were needed. They determined that that we were an essential service. Food, you know, food, I think flowers are too, but so we were allowed to go into the market. The market changed. Instead of being like one tent next to another, we were spaced out, and they actually had people drawing lines on the sidewalk every 6 feet, and people amazingly lined up and that were just so cooperative and so helpful. We started the regulations. We were supposed to wear masks and gloves, and gradually those were loosened a little bit. But what we found was that during COVID, it didn't affect our operation that much, other than the precautions that we needed to take and the rules we had to follow. But we did see that at markets were the markets were just a terrific place where people from that neighborhood, which is not too far from Madison Square Park, we're in Abingdon Square, just wanted to come out and kind of see their neighbors. And so it was a popular place to go. We saw a lot of our regular people, and pretty much the business that we did at the market pretty much made up for the weddings that we lost. This year it looks like, I think we may have another wedding. So we'll see.
So it was our second year, 2020. So we were really impacted. We actually had a CSA our first year, and we only had 3 customers. So our second year, we did a CSA and we had 10 customers because everybody wanted flowers. So I had a farmer friend who said to me, grow everything you can possibly grow this year because people are going to want flowers. So that's what I did. I opened up my high tunnel, which was being used for storage at that moment. And I kicked my husband out of the high tunnel and said, I'm growing in here. So, and it was really nice because the people who joined my CSA, it was kind of like, you know, some of the couples who joined would say, this is our date for the week, coming here to pick up our flowers. And I told them, please feel free to walk around the property, look at the flowers, although usually our flowers are pretty much cut, but it was like we had picnic tables. And so people kind of used it as a little time outside and some time to just have something enjoyable to do. So, and then obviously, and we talked about the changes in the floral industry, it became an opportunity for growers to start to maybe move a little bit into the wholesale market because there were some voids that needed to be filled. So that was, you know, another, and I know we're going to talk about that a little bit more, but that was another way that the pandemic, I think, helped the industry more than hurt the industry as far as local growers go.
Right. Yeah, that's really interesting. I think a lot of people, you know, saw a lot of the negative impacts of COVID, and there certainly were a lot of them. But I think even for us being a public green space and providing that experience for people during a really hard time, and you all providing flowers, it was absolutely essential. So I think everyone would agree with that. So I'd love to dig a little bit deeper into, I know you've kind of thrown around some plant names, but and I know what you grow is extensive, but what kind of maybe specialty items or some of your you know, most prized flowers that you grow, give us some of those. And Candace, if you'd like to start.
Okay. So because I am a floral designer and did weddings for 7 years, I like to grow some of the more frilly flowers, Louisianthus being probably one of my favorites and one of the favorites of floral designers. So I decided I want to grow things that floral designers like rather than, and I do zinnias and I do sunflowers and I do all of those, but I also like to grow some of the more frilly flowers, as I call them. Dahlias are one of my favorite flowers, and they take a lot of work, but people love them. Absolutely. Designers love them. My CSA customers love them. My farm market customers love them. So that dahlias, Elizianthus, and I like to grow a lot of like the, you would call them filler. Some people would call them filler, but I call them like textural elements. I like to have a lot of textural elements in my bouquets. So scabiosa, ami magus, which is Queen Anne's lace. There's a chocolate Queen Anne's lace called Dara, straw flower. This year I'm growing a lot of status. So I try to make sure that I have a good mix of flowers and textural fillers. And also I try to have a lot of foliage, because you really can't make a bouquet without foliage. So eucalyptus, this year I'm growing a lot of new kinds of foliage, trying things out. Mountain mint is really popular. I'm growing anthraplex this year. Euphorbia, yarrow is a biggie. And yarrow actually grows wild in our field, our 5-acre field. So we go into the tall grass with, you know, hat and long sleeves and pants on and just cut yarrow, wild yarrow that's been growing there for, I would guess, centuries. So I think that covers, but I do also love the sunflowers and the zinnias and cosmos and celosia, as Chris said. There's so many different kinds of celosia that you can grow. Again, all different types of textures. I just like a lot of interest, and I like a lot of whimsy and movement in my bouquets. So that gives you an idea of what I'm growing.
Well, that's great. Lysianthus is terrific. We've tried to grow a number of those things over the years, but we've found we kind of do best with some of the things you might see commonly in gardens in this region. So we do a lot of zinnias. The Benary's Giant are the ones that we really like. They're as big as dahlias. So the Benary's Giant zinnias and a lot of different varieties of sunflowers. The Autumn Beauties are great. We like the double sunflowers a lot too, the teddy bear type. So they don't have the ring, the disc in the center. They just have the just petals. Those are very popular. As you said, yeah, we do a lot of celosia. We've been growing a lot of coxcomb lately, which is wonderful texture. And the colors, the deep maroon reds and some of the yellows and pinks are great. And we also, the fan type coxcomb that actually looks kind of like a rooster's comb. And we use those, we put those together in the bouquets. What we do at market is we bring flowers down to market in buckets by species. So we might have anywhere up to 8 or 9 buckets of zinnias and 3 buckets or 4 buckets of celosia and et cetera, et cetera. And then we put them together right there on site and put them out on the table. And we try to have sort of things that look a little different. Some of them have more of a country look. Others are very, very textural, very unusual. And it kind of depends who we have working with us that, you know, everybody puts them together in different ways. And I think we always say there's a person for every bouquet. So put something out there, someone's going to say that's the one that we like. We also do, as Candace mentioned, we love taking yarrow, the wild yarrow. It's mostly the white, but there's also some pink that seems to grow wild. And goldenrod, a lot of goldenrod. Solidago, excuse me, solidago. So, and there's always somebody who's, yeah, I can't believe you're bringing goldenrod in here. I'm so allergic to that. And you know, person could be allergic to anything. You could be allergic to chocolate, right? It's possible, but goldenrod is, you know, you probably know, it probably gets blamed for a lot more allergy than it actually causes. I'll try to tell people if they're receptive that goldenrod is insect pollinated, so the pollen tends to be big and sticky and usually doesn't blow around a lot. Whereas ragweed, which we don't harvest, but is everywhere, is wind pollinated. Pollen is tiny and dusty and thin and blows everywhere and makes you sneeze. We don't harvest ragweed, but we do harvest other types of artemisia, even mugwort. That's kind of the way we do it.
Yeah, that's great. And as a native plant lover myself, I use tons of solidago in my bouquets. And I'm glad you made that distinction for us about ragweed, because that's always a common question. So really quick, I want to make sure that people know where to find you guys. So just talk really briefly about where they can find specifically which farmers market or any community supported agriculture program. Which if you'd like to elaborate on kind of what that means to be involved in it, and any other offerings that I'm missing that you might have. So just really brief, where can people find you? And, you know, Chris, if you want to go first, that would be
sure. We're at probably everybody knows the Green Market system in New York. There's about 50 or maybe more. Where we used to do a number, we do just one now. It's the Abingdon Square Green Market. It's Bleecker and Hudson Street, Saturday mornings. There's a whole bunch of other great food you can get there, food and fish and meat and vegetables and us. So that's our primary outlet. We do some weddings, local weddings near us, and we're in the Hudson Valley region. Most of the weddings we have done lately have been DIY. So you can come to the farm, pick up buckets. That works out really great for some people. It can be a lot of fun if you have somebody who wants to get together, or you have some friends, you want to put together bouquets. With some local venues we work with. That's what we do.
Great.
Okay, so this year we'll be at a new farmer's market. It's not a new farmer's market, but it's new for us. It's called Cook's Market, and it's at Rutgers Gardens in New Brunswick. Rutgers Gardens is a very popular destination in our area. It's beautifully landscaped gardens, a lot of native plants. So this is from 11 to 3 on Fridays. I'll be there starting the third week in June. That's when we'll have enough flowers that we feel like we can, you know, sustain ourselves at a market. We have a CSA, which is almost full. Our session 3 is full, but we have 2 sessions, sessions 1 and 2. Session 1 is July, session 2 is August. And you can go to our website to find out more about that. Our website is Duchess-farms.com. And then we also are selling our flowers wholesale to the floral trade at Jersey Cut Flower Market, which, as you mentioned, I co-founded, and I am the president of the board of Jersey Cut Flower Market, and also acting marketing manager until we find someone. So I have been managing the market since the beginning of April. And it's doing very well, by the way. We have 35 floral designers, paid members, and we are getting more and more busy every week. So I am selling certain kinds of flowers at the wholesale market. Right now I have anemones. That's my big crop right now. And I have some ranunculus and tulips. So that would be for the floral trade. If any floral designers in New Jersey wanted to, are interested in that, it's held in Plainsboro at Byron Barn on Tuesdays from 8 to 10. And there's a platform called Rooted Farmers. It's a platform for farmers to, local farmers to grow, to sell their flowers to designers. And our collective is on that platform. So rootedfarmers.com, a great place to find local flowers.
Great. Okay, so let's get into some more of those sustainable practices, which I'm very excited to hear about. And, you know, it doesn't have to be necessarily what you're doing right now, but what are some of the things you hope to do if you're not doing it already? And what do you hope will come in the future as things evolve and more sustainable practices are developed? You know, where do you see your industry going? Chris, do you want to go first?
Sure. Well, there's definitely a lot of interest in that now. There always has been to a certain extent, but I think people, you know, needed to see that does this stuff actually work? And yeah, it does. We've pretty much done it from the beginning. We did not ever get organic certified because we felt like that was more important if you were selling food than flowers. But we pretty much adhere to the organic guidelines. So what does that mean? That means that by the way, let me say sustainable instead of organic, because organic could mean different things to different people, but let's say maybe even more important that you're able to sustain the practices that are keeping your flowers going. So what does that mean for us? We use organic, it's called organic fertilizer. So that's what it is. So no chemical fertilizer, but organic fertilizer. We don't use any herbicides or pesticides. I guess you would call it integrated pest management, which is my wife going down with a bucket of soapy water and picking off Japanese beetles. But she loves to get them. She feels that they are evil and needs to feel good by removing them from the plants. And she does. It's great. In the evening, sometimes, you know, if she gets off work, there's nothing she'd rather, well, there are few things, but she would loves to go down and pick the beetles. At least that's what she says. Hi, Kim. So that's important. And then the tilling is important too. You want to try not to over till the land, not to make it erode or wear it out from excess tilling or, you know, excess removal of nutrients in the soil. So like I said, we try to use, we get manure in every year. And in order to, when we grow the plants in rows, I guess it used to be called French intensive style, but what it means is we use a plastic mulch. And so that's ends up effectively giving us a row about, let's say 2 foot 6 inches across width-wise and then down the field. So up to 300 or 400 feet long. And then depending what the crops are, we might space, clary sage, let's say 12 inches apart, snapdragons 12 or 15, and then everything up to sunflowers 24 inches apart within that mulch. The advantages of that are also, which I didn't mention, but we don't need to irrigate. We don't need to pump water or use water, or you know, which is a huge issue. Maybe not as much here as it is out west, but it's an issue here. So the mulch traps the moisture from the soil and keeps it, you know, near the plants where they can use it. So by the way, between each of these rows, there's a median. So there's a plastic row with a bunch of holes and plants. Then there's a 42 inch median. Why is it 42 inches? Because that's what my mower is. So I can go down the row and mow the grass and I can walk on it. And it's pretty when I mow it. So then also for weeding, we don't have to weed the entire field or run a cultivator over it. We can go in the holes and just pull out the weeds. And if you get them when the plant is, you know, still young and vigorous, it's going to outcompete the weeds. And there comes a point when you don't have to worry about weeds anymore because that plant is so big that it's really, the weed isn't going to catch up to it. So those are the kind of practices that we use. We debated about the plastic mulch. It's not the greatest thing in the world. You have to get rid of it every year, but we thought in balance, considering what we can actually do, the fact that it saves us so much labor and water and potentially chemicals that it's we feel like it on balance it's worth it to do that, and so that's what we do.
Chris, are you talking about the Bio 360 mulch?
I don't know that particular name, but it's just okay. It's just comes in a bowl.
It's biodegradable, the Bio 360. So that we use this biodegradable, it's called Bio 360 mulch. It's very, very thin and it's a little difficult to work with, but once you get it down, and it basically disintegrates, it's made of like sugar and some other materials, and it disintegrates, not completely, but almost 100%, but you would not be able to use that if you were certified organic. So just to talk about that point, Chris said he's not certified organic, and I actually don't know any flower farmers who are certified organic.
Not either.
And everybody that we interviewed for our co-op, and we talked about their sustainable practices, they all said, we're not organically certified. Like it was a shameful thing, you know, it's so onerous to try to be organically certified that, you know, there's so many rules and regulations that it just makes it so difficult. So we are not also not organically certified, but some of the methods that we use, we are no-till, which means that we do not till. We try, as Chris said, we try to disturb the soil as little as possible. So we will tarp our soil and then broad fork, which is a very physical thing to do and a lot of labor. But it's basically a big fork that you put into the ground, and it just basically aerates the soil and gets it kind of looser. So that's how we create our beds. And then we add compost, to increase that organic material in the soil. And we have been experimenting with some, so there's a difference between sustainable and regenerative. So sustainable is their practices that you can sustain, and you're bringing any materials that you're using are organic, or a lot of people say they only use OMRI listed materials, but even something like neem oil now is getting, like, people are saying that it's not good for the bees. We used to use neem oil, we don't anymore. I'm actually trying to not use anything. Also, like Chris said, integrated pest management is, we have brought in some insects, some beneficial insects, to try to combat the kind of what we call the bad guys. But a lot of people now say there are no bad guys. Every bug has a purpose. But I will be out there at night with my headlamp on, pulling off those Japanese beetles and putting them into a bucket of soapy water. So I'm right there with your wife, Chris. They are evil. But anyway, last year I saw a real improvement in our beneficial insects. We actually had ladybug larvae, which I started jumping up and down like I had won the lottery, because seeing that in your garden is such a good sign that you're doing a good job, that you're attracting the beneficials. And ladybugs are predators, so they eat aphids and, you know, other bugs that would destroy your crops. So I'm really interested to see this year what I have in beneficial insects. What's being attracted. We definitely had monarchs last year, which again was another jump for joy moment, because we're doing it right. So just regenerative, I've started to get into regenerative farming recently. It's kind of become, it's becoming more and more well known, but the Native Americans did this hundreds of years ago, basically using whatever you have in the land to, so you're not bringing in any outside materials. So for instance, one of the things I'm trying this year is something called weed tea. And this is a Korean natural farming method. There's two methods. If anybody wants to look them up at some point, one is called Jadam, which is J-A-D-A-M. And the other is Korean natural farming, KNF. And so weed tea is basically going out, collecting all your weeds, filling up a bucket, adding water and adding some leaf mold, which increases the biology, and the biology breaks down the weeds and ferments the weeds, and that becomes a natural fertilizer. So I'm a geek about this stuff. I love trying out all these recipes, and I've also started a worm farm. So I'm making my own worm compost, worm castings, and we'll use that as a tea as well, for fertilization. I'm trying to think if there's anything else that we're doing. I mean, the regenerative, we're going to try to do that more and more. And I think that's definitely something that we're hoping to get better at in the future. I would love to add native plants to my landscape. That's on my agenda. I need to find the right ones for the places that I want them. Invasives are such a big issue, and we have invasives on our property that we have to deal with at some point. So making sure that we're not planting anything invasive, that all our plants are native and non-invasive. And we're getting, in the fall, we're going to be getting a new high tunnel, which is funded by the USDA, a cost share. So that's another way that we're going to be able to, we're big on stewarding our land and making sure that we're using our land for the best, in the best possible way. And, you know, making sure it's usable for future generations. We're about to become farmland preserved. So nobody will ever be able to develop this property moving into the future. I think that's everything.
There's one more thing that I probably, Candace and I both do, and that is that we don't grow just one kind of plant or two kinds of plants. We grow probably 30 or more different varieties, grow or harvest. Yep. So, you know, instead of a monoculture, if you have a monoculture and you have a pest come along that defeats whatever you have to fight the pest with, you're done. With us, with all those different kinds of plants, it's possible that some insect may come along and get the marigolds, or reproduce different years. Always, we say there's always something that doesn't work out. The bee balm one year didn't do well, but we had many species. And the fact that you have such a diversity of crops in the field means that your chances are you're going to get a harvest. You're going to get something good. You won't be devastated by a pest as you, if you had only one monoculture or one or two crops, you know, you might be looking at a big problem.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, I think that's a really important distinction to make. Mm-hmm. And we've had experiences here with having tons of aphids. All of a sudden you start to see the ladybug larva and you get really excited. And a couple of weeks later, your aphids are gone. I think that diversity really speaks to keeping the pollinators healthy, keeping everyone fed, and it works for you too, for your farms. Mm-hmm. So, and Candace, let's talk native plants one day. I'd love to do that.
Yeah, I need it. I need some advice.
Yeah, I got you. Okay. So I could talk to you guys for hours, but I'm going to pass on now to Ayana, who will do a little Q&A. We only have about 9 minutes left, so we'll answer questions. So I'll pass it to her for now.
Thank you all for that fruitful conversation. It was so touching to hear about like the different ways in which you were a safe harbor, particularly during the pandemic, and just how folks used you as a gathering space and around the flowers. And thanks Jess for moderating for us. So we'll start off with, is there a certain flower that you would like to work with but haven't had a chance or occasion to yet?
That's a great question, Ayana. A corpse flower? That's the big, you know. dahlias. We don't grow dahlias, and they're great, and I know people who do, and they're, but I have not worked with them very much at all.
You know, I just want to say about dahlias, I am so excited that I wintered over my dahlias this year. So I didn't take them out of the ground, which you're supposed to do. I covered them with 12 inches of leaf mulch and tarped them. And one of my gurus that I follow said, she's been doing this for like 6 years. She's perennialized her dahlias and my dahlias came back. I'm so happy. So now I'm gonna plant more in the field and then I'll winter those over too. But it is possible. I don't think you could do it because you're probably too cold where you are.
Yeah.
We're 6B. So we're like 6B, 7A. Yeah. So, but anyway, so flower that I really would like to grow. I wanted to grow Astrantia, which is a beautiful flower and it's a perennial and I would love to have fields of it, but I've never been successful at growing it. So, and the other thing is that I have been growing tulips for 3 seasons. And that's my favorite flower, but I can never, ever get it right. So this year, again, I have tulips, but not the way I want them. So next year I'm going to try no dig tulips where I actually create a raised bed, a temporary raised bed with compost and wood, and then the compost gets moved to other beds after the tulips bloom. And hopefully that'll be like this year I did them in crates and some of them worked and some of them didn't. So I would like to grow those better.
That was great. Maybe we'll just close on this. Both of you pivoted into the field kind of later on in the game. So would you have any advice, maybe something you would have wanted to know beforehand? I know both of you were kind of like lied to about what your day would look like, but you know, any advice for someone who wants to start their own cut flower farm?
Well, I guess as a grower, we feel like, well, we could pretty much grow anything. Not anything, but we're pretty good. We know when to put a flower in the field and when to harvest and buy the flowers. But what I think one of the things that came as a lesson to me is you need to sell the stuff. If you want to stay in business, it's you need to have a market. When I first started in the business of the horticulture business, the Green Market was great. Farmers markets were great. It was very difficult to sell wholesale, at least at a price where you could make a profit. That seems to be changing now. And I think it's great what Candace is doing with the co-op. So just being clear about what your market is, who you're going to sell to, and what you can expect to earn from it. What, you know, can you keep going with it? What, you know, you have to invest in some equipment and some land, maybe labor. Are you going to cover those costs? Are you going to produce enough? And there's different ways too. There's no single answer. People do agritourism. People do have homestays on the farm. Co-ops, CSAs, farmers markets, wholesale. It's a mix. So I would say to somebody who's starting, get a really good handle on the different options that you have, what you're going to grow, maybe particular specialty flowers could be good. And then, you know, look at it that way. And I would say get very familiar with machinery. Learn to fix an engine. That would be good.
I mean, I would definitely echo what Chris said, although we don't use much machinery. We do, I mean, lawnmowers, obviously, but I would say the physicality of it. I mean, I came into farming at 50 years old. And I had no, like, you know, I just think I can do anything. Like, I'm Superwoman. I had no idea how physical this was going to be. And so you have to be prepared for that. And you have to stretch a lot and do yoga. That's how I do keep doing all of this strenuous work. But I did also want to say really quickly, you know, we didn't talk about, and I'm sure you've talked about local flowers in other sessions that you've had, but we didn't really talk about the fact that 80% of flowers purchased in the United States are imported, and obviously 20% are locally grown. So what I would say to the people that, you know, are listening is, when you go to the supermarket, ask where your flowers are coming from. Because the only way that we're going to change the system that we're in right now is to demand that it change. So that's my PSA for local flowers. I can't talk about local flowers without saying, please ask where your flowers are coming from.
Yeah, that's one of the nice things about a farmer's market, at least a well-run market like Green Market. You cannot sell anything you haven't grown, and you can't right. from outside the area. You know, there's the span of people's areas that can come to New York Green Market is pretty large. It actually goes into New Jersey, into Pennsylvania, upstate. So, but you have to be within a certain radius of New York City.
Yeah.
So,
but
go on.
I'm sorry, Chris, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
That's okay.
It's just so passionate about this. When you see a bunch of dahlias in a store for $5, it's just so, it undercuts local flowers, local farmers. And so I just think it's really important that people be aware of that. And I think it's really important. And I know you're going to have Deborah Prinzing on at talking about the slow flowers movement. And she is a guru. And I'm so glad you're having her on. And she'll talk about that a lot. So I hope people watch that, because I think it'll be really valuable. I'm doing a PSA for your next segment. So I'll just shut up on that now.
No, that was, it's a good way to close our program with kind of like a call to action, and like,
yes,
a way exactly. to practice mindfulness all in one. So I'll just say that this conversation was like wonderful. I think everyone's learned so much, and you know, there's still so much more to learn. So we're going to forward any unanswered questions to you both. And okay. The questions will be shared later on in future correspondence. And this concludes tonight's program. I want to thank you both and thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Gosh, there's so much more to be discussed. But
yeah, but so well done. Yes. So well done on your part. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ayanna. Thanks, Jess, for having us. It's been really fun. Yes.
Thanks. And thank nice you. Meeting you, Chris.
Yeah, you too. Let's stay in touch.
Definitely. Okay.
All right.
Bye-bye. Everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.